So what is it that demands the reinventing of education for life in the 21st century? My belief is that, as what Mr. Eddie Ng said this morning, the focus must be on the learner. How to prepare the learner to be relevant in the time, be able to contribute to the development of the economy, as well as an active contributor to shape the type of society, the community that we want to evolve in the days to come. And I often say this to my educators in Singapore, know that service learning, character and citizenship education, it's just so important in addition to the academic excellence that you're talking about. The key reason, simply because through your hands, you determine what the future society will be. Through your hands, you will determine what type of citizens that we will be raising up in the future. Are we going to raise up a society and a community that cares for one another? You know, that really, what you call, support one another? Or are you raising up a society where individualism becomes the key and a characteristic of the society? This is something education has to look at. So today, when I talk about reinventing education for life for the 21st century, many of the views may be my personal. Okay, I'm not sharing what the Singapore education system emphasizes, although there is a lot of overlap, but I have different thinking in different areas which I thought that it is a food for thought, you know, for all. Okay. Now, when we talk about reinventing education, there must be drivers that pushes the reinvention. So it is important for us to look at the drivers that really demands education, the reinvention of education. I think Mr. Eddington this morning has spoken very eloquently about the drivers, the learner and the society and so on. But I just want to talk about a little bit about the 21st century demands. I think these are not unfamiliar to all of you. So in education, if I repeat it, it is in the spirit of reinforcement, not long-windedness. Okay? Okay? So I just talk a little bit about this as a reinforcement and a refreshment. But I will also add in the new thoughts of what it is about. I think there are four drivers in the progress and development of the world that demands a relook at education, and not just a relook, but a continual relook, because the changes that is taking place today is just so fast. It's just so fast. In fact, today, the estimate that new knowledge is doubling has been reduced from 2.5 years now to 2 years. It used to be doubling once in 12 years or one in 25 years. It used to be. Today, so much knowledge is evolving that knowledge doubles once in every 2 years. So in that kind of speed, if education still stays, you know, in one position where other things are moved ahead, that's why you will lag behind. And the learners that you are going to educate will be lagged behind. Even the most conservative of societies, like in the Middle East, they're really opening up. You know, and there is a strong emphasis in the Middle East now for bilingualism. While they maintain Arabic as their key language, they're very much focused on the education of English. So one day I asked one of the directors of education, I said, why are you so fanatic and so geared up, you know, in terms of English language learning? And he replied to me in his broken English. Okay? He said, I go internet, click Arabic, only 5 pages. In other words, now you go to search engines, yeah? If you click the in the Arabic language, you know, there's only 5 pages of information resource. I click English, cannot count. That means the knowledge of the world is contained in the English language. And if his people are not equipped, especially the younger ones, to be able to tap into the knowledge of the world, the society will remain where they are, or whatever they can get. So that's why they're against their own grain and culture. They are driven to reinvent themselves. That's why the demands of the 21st century, I take it as 4 areas. Okay? I go into each one of them. Now, 21st century skills. These are all very much common to you. I like this NASA directed learning as applied this morning. Amy told me, says that this morning when I accompanied the group to Hopewell, this is a Hopewell building, says that I will be among the group and I will not direct them or lead them because they have gone through that journey yesterday. Today they should learn how to apply self-directed learning. I thought that was a great spirit of it showed. Okay. Now, why self-directed learning? If you read the many articles today, future, what you call crystal ball gazers have said this, and thought leaders have said this. As students of today, going into the school system, will graduate in 12 years' time, K-1 to 12. Then another 3 to 4 years in the university. And when they come out, the knowledge that is today existing while they're in primary one, and the landscape that the child will graduate after K-12 or the university, it can be 2 different worlds. Whatever he learned here will be all obsolete. And again, secondly, today we talk about loyalty to an institution, right? We say, oh, I'm very proud that I've been with this institute for 25 years. Yeah. Says that in the future, in fact today it is already the case, many of the employment terms are based on contract. There is no more permanent, very little permanent employment. Why contract? Because the company is very clear. How their company's work is going to evolve in 5 years' time, nobody can predict. The type of job skills that you require from workers, you can't predict. Okay? So therefore, it is best to go on contract so that in 5 years' time, we see how the company has evolved and the different type of job skills that's required. And if that existing employee can be sent for retraining and be able to acquire the new skills, he can stay for another contract. Okay? But if, let's say, that employee cannot, what you call, acquire the new skills, he'll be redundant within the company. And how many cycles are this? The thought leaders estimated that in the lifetime of a career in the future, you need to learn, unlearn, and relearn 8 times. 8 times. Okay? So therefore, self-directed learning is very much the important attribute. In fact, one of the most important focus of education today is to teach students to learn how to learn so that they can be self-directed learners. Now, the last here, it is very important. In a knowledge-based economy, everybody say it is knowledge is an asset. It is wrong. Knowledge can only be an asset when you apply it to create value. Knowledge will only remain a knowledge and not an asset if you cannot apply it to derive value. Now, value doesn't mean just financial terms. Value must be measured in many different dimensions from an angle of impact. How does the application of your knowledge impact society? That is value. If you have a certain what you call, like for example, Jim Collins, he has a lot of knowledge about what leadership is. But that knowledge will only remain a knowledge if he does not communicate that knowledge to impact society and impact community. And that's what he has done, you know, writing that book from good to great, so that it can really impact the thinking of leaders around the world, you know, the causing leaders, drive them to reflect and to exercise the type of leadership that will really bring up the organization, that will really bring up the development of outcomes of the organizations, and so on. So entrepreneurship in the future becomes a very strong key in terms of value that you would bring and the impact that you will bring. Okay? And that's why today, even in the area of social work, there is such thing, you know, so commonly now known around the world, social enterprise. Social enterprise is actually social entrepreneurship. You know, in many what you call social dimensions, it depends on charity. It depends on the support of the community. While that is still important, I think social enterprise can be very much a domain of activity where you generate your own activities to help your own charity. Even in that domain, this is now very much emphasized. Yeah, I don't need to talk about the demands of the digital learners, right? We call them EPIC learners, E-P-I-I-C. Yeah, EPIC, EPIC learners. Yeah, I have spoken this on many occasions, no, and I don't know whether I repeated it to some of you. Yeah, today's students are very experiential in the learning. Let me share with you one very simple example. I have two professors who taught a subject of deserts. One professor is quite traditional, you know, very dedicated, devoted, went to the books and scanned, you know, desert slides onto the PowerPoint, etc., you know, and he came and tried to give a good lecture. And much to his great disappointment, you know, he see his audience very much, students, you know, very much in agreement with him, you know, by nodding, you know. Very much in agreement with him. So that is one scenario. The second scenario of a younger, what you call a professor, he used his iPad, Google Map, and he brought in real-time scenario into the classroom. Google, you know, Gobi Desert, Sahara Desert, you know, and bringing different dimensions. And in one case, he was so lucky that there was a sandstorm being what got blown up, and he could bring that real-time picture into the classroom. The whole what you call class was in excitement because they can see the real thing. They can experience the reality of the topic that they study. So our students, the way they learn is very different. I have a granddaughter only 2 years old. This is her favorite toy. Okay, Ye-Ye's handphone. 2 years old, before she began two, she can press this. She can slide it down. That's her, you know. That's her. Yeah. She can slide this. The only thing she doesn't know is the code. But she knows that she has to press here to open up the whole thing. But she cannot count, no? So she just like that. Now, 2 years old, she can do this. Just imagine, just imagine when she's 7, she's 12, and she is 15. How do you interest a child? They are born with that natural, what you call, digital capability. See, of course, today if I want to do something very different on my iPhone, no, or iPad, I will ask my daughter or my son. Well, I don't know how to do it, but they know. You know, they will tell you, you know, Dad, no, you're so stupid. Well, you just press this button and you get all that function come out. And one of the most difficult tasks of an educator today is actually facing these digital natives. You know why? Today, just as you begin to talk about a certain topic, your student at the back is already Googling. Yeah? And they will ask you questions that you may not know, because someone wrote about that subject already, and they are able, they are fast readers, I don't know why. You know, they get, I read, for 5 minutes, no, they just 2 minutes, one scan, no, they know the gist of the message. That's today's student. So that demands a change to our education, demands the way we teach, demands the change to the role of the teacher. So this is the learner's driver. The third is the job market itself. You know, today with the evolving technology, the nature of jobs have changed actually in every dimension. Today, a cleaner does not need to use the broom anymore. He can just drive a little machine and clean up the area with efficiency, with impact, you know, and quality that is unprecedented. People sweep, there's still some dirt left behind, but the machine will clean it. But that cleaner requires added skills, added knowledge. No more, you know, simple, you know, just use a broom and sweep. This is manual and you don't need much teaching. You only need a little bit more supervision to ensure that the quality is good. But for a cleaner who uses technological enablers, they need new skills. They need to understand how to operate the machine. Now, these new skills require certain basic knowledge. Will all this change? How do we equip our students with the type of knowledge, with the type of skills, and the attributes that will enable them to evolve with the job demands? As I said, 8 cycles. There'll be 8 cycles of job demands in a lifetime of a worker today. So how do we build in them all these new skills, new attitudes? How do we build in them the desire to pick up all these new skills? You know, even in driving, today people are talking about the driverless car. Google has put the driverless car on the road for many years, and they found that they have only 2 accidents. And this accident is not caused by the inability of the car to sensing, you know, from the sensor point of view, but it's because the car is over efficient in terms of sensing. That at certain juncture, there's a very, what you call, emergency stop, and the car is able to stop well. But the back car with the driver cannot stop well, and it ram into the Google car. So you have 2 accidents of that nature caused by cars with drivers. But a driverless car can manage in itself. So this is the new world that we are going into. We may not have taxi drivers anymore. Yeah? If we have taxi drivers, I think the role of the taxi driver will be very different. Yeah? So that's what the third driver. The fourth driver, I think Hong Kong and every country in the world is facing this. Social media pervasiveness. Now, the social media provides, inverted commas, a cover for your identity to be exposed. And as an outcome, it can veer from freedom of speech, you know, in such a way to an area of irresponsibility. You can, today, you know, that there are situations where people are being, that's what you call cyberbullying, is it? You know, people are being tormented by sometimes false information, false accusation, etc. There is just so much change in the way communication is done, in the way information are being distributed. Some information can just go viral. You know, I just learned the word viral. What does viral mean? You know, I thought viral is always virus, you know, but actually in the social media, it simply means that it just go wild. Yeah. So therefore, in terms of ethics, values, and morals, there is a great what you call change. What is my personal responsibility? What is integrity? What is honesty? What is telling the truth? And what is my responsibility of false accusation? Now all this are beginning to blur in a social media frenzy. You know, if I get angry with that one, you know, the girl, you know, she rejected my whatever advancement. Is that right? Is that the society that we want to evolve into the future? And how does education play a part in managing this? So these are four very common, you know, knowledge of what the four drivers is. So therefore, we look at this whole landscape of going in the future. How then can education reform? With the vast knowledge coming on board, how do we educate our students with the right set of knowledge, with the right sets of values, and with the right sets of attributes that will enable them to be relevant in the 21st century? And in fact, 21st century, we are already in the 14 years. We shouldn't be using the word 21st century. No, we are now in a literally into the midst of the 21st century. No more, you know, the iconic term. But it is how to respond to changes, how to respond to evolution of technology, that education must play a part to help our learners to be relevant with the time. So there are four areas that I'd like to talk about in terms of how education can respond. Number one is curriculum. Now, curriculum help to shape the understanding and the knowledge of a learner. But as I said, you know, with knowledge now doubling once in every 2 years, so much knowledge is available. The answer is what to educate comes to mind. What knowledge should we impart to the student? So this is where curriculum in terms of its design and its development needs to be reinvented. Now let me share with you some of my thoughts in this area. You see, if you look at the way in which curriculum is developed in 1980s, 1990s, it is actually based on a spiral model. In other words, at a primary school level, you talk about a subject, and that same subject is being repeated in the secondary school, but with a deeper, what you call, coverage. And then it will be repeated in the highest secondary school, no? Senior secondary school. Okay. So as an outcome, if you still adopt this model, the amount of content that you need to provide this input will grow at every level. And if you want to include all those knowledge in there, where do you have the time within the school hours that you are allocated to teach certain subject? There is absolutely no more capacity. In fact, in many of the education systems that I saw, one of the fundamental mistakes they make is they just add on and no cutoff. So as an outcome, the teacher used to complain, I cannot finish my curriculum this year. I cannot finish my syllabus this year. So especially when I went to China, you know, they asked me this. So I said, there's something must be wrong with your curriculum if you cannot finish it within the school time that you have. You need to relook at it. So in Singapore, we have already began to look at it as early as the year 2000. Let me share with you how some of this can be relooked at. Take from for example, biology, life science. My biology, so is Professor Liu Tan. No? So these are subjects that are very much I'm passionate in what, how do we educate our students, you know, from the angle of biology to help them acquire the basic knowledge as well as being able to also acquire values and ethics as part of that process of learning. We look at the knowledge at that point of time, you know, the molecular biology coming in, DNA science coming in, nanotechnology coming in. There is just so much what you call things that needs to be looked at and acquired. How can then we develop a curriculum within that landscape such that it is coherent and enable our students to acquire the knowledge and the values? We thought a lot about this and we came up with a model. We asked ourselves a basic question. What is actually biology? Biology is to help our students to learn how life works. Simple as that. You can have all kind of definition, no? But to me, biology is the study of how life works. So therefore, we have primary, secondary, and the junior college. So we ask ourselves three questions at three particular levels. For a primary school, we need to give a broad knowledge to our students of what life, how life works. So we ask the question, how life works at the system level. What is system level? System level is that how do I, as a member, you know, of the living things on earth, relate to one another within the global environment. First begin with your community, then within the region, and then within the globe. So how life works as a system? Ecology, ecosystem. Understanding the needs of other organisms, and so on. So through that, we will help the primary school students to understand that in this world, I am not alone. Even as I live among the human community, my activities has an impact on life of the other communities. Take for example, if I were to throw a piece of plastic paper irresponsibly, the plastic paper will flow down the drain into the river and then get caught in the mangrove swamp. And if that plastic paper accumulates, you know, through many irresponsible acts, then the mangrove plants will suffer, and more so will be the marine organisms within the mangrove. So we help the students to talk, to understand, and relate himself or herself to the whole environment. And that also helps to give the values of responsibility. Okay? Now, we move on to the second level, at the secondary school level. So here how life works as a system. When you look at the secondary school, students are growing up, right? They are turning from young, as a child into adolescence. Adolescents will be very sensitive of oneself, identity, and so on. And also at the adolescent stage, you are very much prone to what you call geared to a certain activities and certain desires. You know, if you look, you know, smoking, they would like to try smoking. They'll try drinking. And some of them will go even one step further, they'll try drugs. Right? Very much prone to such activities. So very much on self. So therefore, at the secondary school level, we focus on another question. How life works at the physiological level. So therefore, you can still bring in the basic knowledge of physiology, how the body system works, how the plant system works. Then you will know that if I engage myself in such activities, how it will impact my health and the working of my body. So second question, how life works at the physiological level. Now for the higher school students who are very much academically inclined and they are able to go towards university level and so on, we can ask now at a deeper question, how life works at the genetic and the molecular level. So therefore, if you cut this into three depths of subjects, you don't need to repeat. You are covering new knowledge, new domains, and through all this, you also have values and ethics very much incorporated with. So therefore, the curriculum design needs to be reinvented, needs to be re-looked at. How do you coherently able to design a curriculum in the midst of this knowledge explosion? Thank you very much. That our students and learners will be given the basic foundation, a very much a basic understanding that cannot shape just their knowledge foundation, but also shape their values and their ethics. And in addition to that, I think a greater part of values and ethics needs to be emphasized, particularly on the matter of self-responsibility, integrity, honesty. Like I take, for example, the social media pervasiveness. How can our students be educated to exercise responsibility of social media communication? That they ought not to harm, but to enhance the benefits of social media capability. So that aspects of curriculum need to be reinvented. Likewise, you know, you can do it for all the other subjects, except that I'm just very much passionate about biology and life science, and I work a lot on this with the Ministry of Education to redevelop this model. Pedagogy. I already said how our students' learning profiles are like, the epic learners. If today, the well-respected, gentlemanly English professor were to stand on the pedestal and give a lecture without a PowerPoint, I think you'll get very low student feedback. Today, students need to be engaged. They want to participate in a process. So you have to now shift the learning from the teacher-centric approach to a student-centric approach, just exactly as what Mr. Edison spoke about this morning. It's no more teaching and learning, it's learning and teaching. The learner becomes our focus. And today, we also need to talk about customized, personalized learning apart from a one model fits all. Because today, many of our students are very much differentiated by their style of learning. Some may be very much academically inclined, and those you need to stretch them academically. But there are others who acquire learning through hands-on activities. You ask them, you know, a question of why, just to articulate that subject in a form of a composition or an article, the student may perform very poorly. But if you ask them to engage in the design and the development of a certain, what you call real-time or real case study, how to apply the knowledge in it, sometimes they may learn better. They will learn what you call better. So as an outcome, the type of pedagogy that you need to adopt in just, whether it be in a primary school, secondary school, or even in tertiary education, really need to have a relook. But I can tell you this is something that is most challenging. Because educators are also people of their own comfort zone. Not creatures of their own comfort zone. They will just do what they have been comfortable in doing since the 20th century, you know, didactic teaching, you know, with a little bit of PowerPoint and thinking that you've done great. But today, if the professors do not change, if the teachers do not change, do not shift from adopting pedagogies that are very much identified with the different learning profiles within the classroom, I think the learning impact of the student will be very, very poor. What Mr. Ng says is absolutely correct. Today you need to talk about the learning of the student. What have they studied? It is not just the knowledge. Acquisition of knowledge is not learning. Learning is understanding the knowledge, how to identify that knowledge in terms of its relevance to various circumstances. That is learning. Even the definition of learning have to be clarified so that educators can understand how to approach it. So pedagogies is no more didactic teaching alone. I list down this is just as a kind of simple examples to you. The different types of pedagogy is just a whole range. I was recently working with my university's computer department. You know. I said that if I were to create a repository of all technological enablers that one can use as part of pedagogical tools for professors to apply, I said, what kind of capacity, you know, of the learning platform that you can create in terms of gigabytes? He gave me a number that shocked me. Yeah, because there are so many different learning systems now available. So many different learning technological enablers that one can use. You know, today, in NIE, my colleagues are already using the WhatsApp. So today, we use WhatsApp to talk about the LEP conference, you know? Yeah? My colleagues have produced apps that teaches the students how to pronounce phonetics. And, of course, they just photograph the mouth and the lips. Don't photograph the face. The student will look more at the face than the lips. Yeah? She can do all the pronunciations of the various vowels and consonants as well as the words on the apps platform. And students can just download from the simple apps platform and then sit in a bus or at night, you know, can't sleep, you know, you can just put the earphone on the ear and then you just click. And that's where you can learn. You can learn to pronounce. You can learn, you know, to understand. So technological enablers are just so ample now today. It's whether you want to make an effort to look at them to see which can be best applied in the domain of your subjects that you are teaching. The third is the learning environment. Now, many of our classrooms are designed for the 20th century learning, very much didactic based. The tables and desks are aligned row by row, where the active person in the classroom is the teacher, and the students are the passive learners. Today, if you want to talk about the 21st century pedagogy and picking up 21st century skills, you need to change. And that must start actually at the very top of the teacher, the chain. If you want to produce teachers that can filter down to do all this, it must start at the teacher education level. So at the NIE, we revamp our teacher education. We literally reinvent teacher education in 2009 in response to all this. Then when I looked at the type of desired outcomes that we want to build in the teachers, we realized that our didactic teaching environment have to change. So today, NIE's classroom is now all technological enabled. See, every table, you have a power supply. Because now everyone using either a laptop or this iPad, you need power supply. People now like to work as a group. And we adopted what we call the flip classroom technology, pedagogy. Most of our content, information, are now hosted on the learning management system. Students are able to read, and when they come to the classroom, basically it will be more of discussion. Discussion will be in groups. And you notice that the writing boards now is all around the classroom. So if this group is here, they can connect their computer to the screen and they can write here as they discuss. So you see, with a setup like this, we can really pick up four very 21st century skills very effectively. Let me explain to you. When you work as a group, you need collaborative skills to collaborate. And you need interpersonal skills. You know why? Because in any discussion, there will be diversities of views and differences of views. So you have to, first of all, respect diversity of views. You cannot impose your views on others. But if you want to really influence that discussion by your views, your leadership skills must come in. How to convince others to embrace your views. So respect for diversity, yeah, collaborative skill, working together. And when you discuss, you ask questions, thinking skills. And when you integrate your presentation together, that is innovative and creative skills. And when you present to the other groups, communicative skills. You see, all the skills are very much enhanced through this whole design. Now, you may notice that this classroom is rather colorful, right? Across the whole institute, we have different models of design and different colors, color scheme. Now, you may think that a little color scheme, the little feature down there, you know, what is so important about it? For today's digital learner, that's very important. Vibrancy. They dislike the dull color of, you know, the yellow, the gray wall or whatever it is. You know, they will tell me, you know, it doesn't stimulate my thinking. Wow. You know? So there are classrooms where our panels could be black and with red lining. There are other classrooms with psychedelic, what you call, colors on the panel and all those. So all these are now designed literally to engage the learner. We are literally transferring the ownership of learning from the students, also from the teacher to the student. And even the professor's table is being moved to the side. No more at the center. We are telling the professor, you are no more the monopoly of knowledge. You are now the facilitator of learning. But having done this, we are not just staying stagnant. You know, we have incorporated all this technology. Now it is easier for us now to use this basic platform to enhance the applications of the learning classroom. See, there may be game-based technology that can be incorporated. And students may not need just to discuss. Students may even engage in the process of learning and teaching. And the professors co-learn with them. But to have this to be successful, the poor professor have to be supported. Okay? Because the professors, you know, they may like to do all this, but they may not have the computer skills. They may not have the expertise to translate their content knowledge into a digital resource. So they need to have a lot of support. And I must be very glad to say that my NIE professors are very much embracing this. And now, today, this is the norm across the whole institute. We have 72 tutorial rooms. They are all transformed and continually upgraded when there is a new feature that comes in. Yeah. Nintendo technology is incorporated in some of the physical education lab. So the students are being taught how to play the golf before they go into the field to play test out. No? They're test out in the classroom to show how poor they are. So, this is not only it. The library. Every norm must also be challenged. I think this was the first model, Mark I, was done in the days when Professor Tan was the director. See, the normal paradigm of a library is what? Silence. If today, if that paradigm continues to remain, the library will really be silent. Because there won't be any students there. So, in 2003, a section of the library was converted into a cafe. At that time, it is just to mainly to provide, you know, an environment where students can gather. We call it the learning hub. But this has now been expanded to the whole of the third floor of the library. And now you can also say the Hot Shot Cafe, you know, has been expanded in capacity. And when you go into the library in this floor in the morning, you can't find a space. Every table will be filled with students, either on the laptop, iPad, or engaged in discussion. And we have all the empowerment to support them in terms of power supply, in terms of Wi-Fi, in terms of even connecting to other learning systems within the university. They can access it all together. So your learning environment must be reinvented. Yeah? This is another view. Yeah, this is just when it is completed. Yeah, you go there, now you can't find a single place. I brought visitors to the place and I had to apologize. No? I said, let us have a coffee and stand at a little table there and drink. We don't have a place to sit down. So, as we move forward to the 21st century, we have to really change every norm. Challenge every norm. That is why the LEP International brochure you know, that we have what you call produce, is to encourage our participants to challenge assumptions. So all of you as alumni, we know that you are challenging assumptions. Pidek, you know, has just gone to do his higher degree and came back to challenge assumptions on how the NIE in Cambodia is to be operated. So this must be the paradigm of today's education. If you want to talk about reinventing education for life, it's a continual journey, but it must start first with this basic fundamental. If we just continue to believe that what is working will continue to work, you will be slightly on the wrong track. You need to challenge assumptions. Okay? Now, changing roles of teachers. We realize how teachers' role in a school must change to facilitate group learning, collaborative learning, engagement learning. So that's how we have to transform teacher education within NIE. Not just to prepare the new breed of teachers, but also to professionally develop existing teachers. Now, with schools, the school leaders, you can do your part to reinvent learning and teaching in a classroom among your teachers. And this is something, it is very much important. Role modeling. Now, role modeling, here I know teachers today have great expectations by parents, by schools, and by the authorities on what teachers ought to do. But on a fundamental level, we realize that the greatest impact of a teacher on the student is actually in the area of role modeling. If the teacher does not change in terms of the way teaching is to be done, or if a teacher behavior, say, in the area of social media communications or display and all those, your students will pick that up very well, very much. You know, very often in Singapore, there's a discipline problem of students, say, using four-letter words, swearing, and all those in the schools, you know. So one of the teacher thought, I need to speak to the parents, yeah, of how to educate their children and control them. So as the teacher was walking towards the house of the parents, he heard all these words coming out of the house, you know, the parents are talking. So no wonder the children pick it up, you see. Then there was this story of the Minister of Education, Mr. Teo Chee Hian. He visited one school and saw the child's hair is red in color, you know. And the teacher tried to, principal tried to educate the child, no effect. So the minister somehow, you know, had this notion. He said, maybe I will invite the parents, you know, for a chit-chat, yeah. So he invited the parents to his office for a chit-chat. You know. And as the parents came in, he saw the parents' hair was pink. So he had to change his stance of how to talk to the parents. Now he said, educate the parents first and then the children. But teachers in the school, you are actually spending a lot of time with the students. And the students somehow takes affinity towards the teacher. The teacher's behavior has a great influence, whether in terms of values and ethics, whether in terms of passion and, you know, dedication and devotion. The children can tease out of what the teacher's attributes can be. You cannot bluff children today. They know every, what you call, action of yours. And that's why we have to tell the teachers, inculcate in them the sense of values. You know, the teacher education model of NIE, the first begins with three sets of values. The learner-centered values. we want to inculcate in the teacher to understand that, take for example, I believe that every child can learn. If that belief is in the teacher, the perspective and the way in which the teacher reacts in the classroom will be very different, where I believe that only the good ones can learn, right? I believe in diversity, that these are all different learners. Then the second set is teacher identity. Who am I as a professional? We want to sensitize the teacher that they have a great role to play, not just in terms of knowledge impartation and building up the foundational knowledge, but role modeling. We want the teacher to understand the impact that he can or she can bring to the students. And the third is professional community. We want to create pride in the whole teaching profession. Because if the teaching profession don't have that pride, how can you stand up and tell the society the good works that you have done? And how do you build among yourself the ability to improve your profession? So all this needs a reinvention. No more the days of, I'm a teacher, I just come to teach, and that's my job. Today, you have a greater role beyond that teaching. Now we talk a lot about K-1 to 12, but what about higher education? I think today, if you look into the US platform of journal articles and newspaper report, there is an increasing amount of articulation and discussion about learning and teaching in higher education. Because for all too long, tertiary education has very much stayed for what they think, inverted commas, the ivory tower. That they know it best. That they know it all. Today, the days of that thinking and landscape is the days of the past. If you do not respond, you will literally be regarded as dinosaurs of higher education. Right. Yeah. Today, if you don't change your pedagogy in the university, let me tell you what the consequence will be. Your schools are already transforming in pedagogy. And if these students throughout their journey and then their way of learning and teaching, you know, is very much modernized and technologically supported and enabled, and they come to the university and hear this professor talking about this, you know, that it's a regression rather than progression. So therefore the university have to really change. Now, more importantly, I'm also beginning to challenge the question. What does it mean when you're given a Bachelor's of Science? What does it mean when you're given a Bachelor's of Arts, or Accountancy, or Engineering? Have you defined what this program desired outcomes is in relation to preparing this student for the working world? The working world of today, when things are changing so fast. Is the basic training of bachelor's or education or bachelor's or engineering still relevant? In fact, if you talk about bachelor's of education, it is a degree of the past. Almost every university today are removing that program because it is considered, inverted commas, an archaic qualification that really doesn't give any meaning to what that qualification means. Today, you can see many universities, especially some of the reputable ones, beginning to evolve degrees of a different nature that you may not have heard of. That's why I question. You know, I asked my university, can you tell me, is your Bachelor's of Science still relevant today as far as a qualification is concerned. In this new landscape, where your graduates are going out, you know, to do whatever jobs that they may be involved in, is a degree still relevant for that preparation? I think we can only be satisfied with ourselves where we can articulate and clarify what it means to be a BSc graduate or a BA graduate or a BE graduate. Now, even the question about is a degree still relevant today? Is the degree still, that means that does a student need a degree in order to advance in his career? Although in today's context, it may still be regarded, you know, as something important. But slowly, I can tell you, it is going to be eroded. Take, for example, Lucasfilm. What does Lucasfilm do? Creativity, right? Animation, creativity, you know, special effects and all those. And one of our ministers went to visit Lucasfilm was shocked to find out, you know, all those people down there, okay, half of them doesn't have a degree. So George Lucas said, no, why do I need a degree? Because if they can produce provide the expertise that can achieve my end goals, what do I care about whether you have a degree or not? So therefore, we will even have a question, you know, about, you know, should the future, you know, university provide professional certificates rather than a degree? You know, that the accumulation of those professional certificates will show your latest relevance to the type of skill that you acquire, not a degree itself. It is very much a radical thinking, but as I look at today's landscape and the changing needs, you know, the degrees, the type of awards and the processes awards will have to be really looked at. I don't think it can change within my lifetime. I will look from heaven to see how the progress can change. But I believe it will change. Today, if you look at the... In fact, I just got an article this morning, you know, by Mark Weinberger. He talks about, you know, say I didn't go to the top university. I didn't, you know, aspire to fulfill the hopes of my parents. I just did what I am led and driven by my passion. And today is one of the regarded as one of the top thinkers in the field of corporate management. That is what the landscape of today, of what success is and what things can move forward. So with this changing landscape, which will never stop for now, and the pace of change will come faster, how should education respond and reinvent ourselves such that we can prepare the student for a career in life that will encounter all this? I better stop here before I bored all of you, you know. So in fact, the last point that I want to talk of is assessment. Different curriculum, different pedagogies, you must have a different assessment. Assessment not so much, you know, to really give an A or a B to the student, but really the assessment of learning, for learning. You know, what learning has the student take place in the process of that learning? Has the student pick up the desired skills, desired knowledge that we really meant for the students to pick up? Not just, at the end of the day, a grade A or a grade B for a subject through an exam. So this is something I think we need to reinvent ourselves. And with the use, the availability of technology enablers, I believe this change can be easily looked at. And a lot of research are being done in that. And I have set up a center within my university actually to relook at assessment at the tertiary level. Tertiary level is still very much exam-based, but we want to move away from that. We want to move away and go into domains of assessment for learning. Maybe difficult, but it is something that is a necessity of the future. So that's my conclusion, that you need to change. Without change, you will be a dinosaur of the future. And change is the So thank you very much for holding the work.
Now let's take a short break. Feel free to enjoy some light refreshments on your left. Thank you. And we'll be back before 11 o'clock.